So good morning, everyone. Let's start the lecture. As usual, we have 1 hour for the lecture itself and then 20 minutes for questions and discussion. Please don't forget about the mic when asking the questions. I'll be behind you to give it to you. And once again, we kindly ask you, the participants, not to use your laptops and computers during the lectures. Thank you so much. So Koen, the floor is yours.
Thank you. Good morning, everybody. I hope you had a good night yesterday. Yes, you all slept very well. Are you awake? Your presentations are ready? Yes, very good, very good. I saw many people late at night walking around thinking about, what should I do? And good. We will talk about contagion and financial markets and CCPs. Of course, it's obvious why this is interesting. We all still remember the 2008-2009 crisis. It also struck Russia by surprise. Well, by surprise is maybe too much to say. In fact, it's Russia's fifth financial crisis in 20 years, but it was our first. In fact, in Belgium, it was the first in 70 years. And the interesting thing was, at the moment it happened, the financial crisis and the contagion on the financial markets, there were quite a few models around, but generally they were wrong. We had no understanding actually how financial contagion actually works. And that was, in a way, part of the problem. So what I will discuss in very general, simple terms is how I think contagion actually runs, and then I will discuss a few papers, and then I will discuss a few solutions. Do you hear me at the end? Is it loud enough? Okay, perfect. I would like to start with Allen and Gale. Allen and Gale have a very old paper. It's one of the classics written before the crisis, and they wrote a model of contagion. They call it the capital channel of contagion. And this capital channel of contagion is an idea that is essentially wrong. But at that moment, that was what everybody believed. And what is the idea of the capital channel of contagion? The idea is very simple. Imagine all of you are banks, and all of you have relations with one another. So Sasha has lent money to Lena, and Lena to Olga, and Olga to whomever, to Katja. And they all have relations with each other. So basically what that defines is a network of contracts. And the nodes are the banks, and the edges are the credits, right? And that's our network. And what is then the capital channel? The capital channel is the following idea. Each node, each bank, has some capital. And if you have lent money to someone else, and that other person fails for some reason, you lose that money. If that money that you lose is larger than your capital, you die. The note is crossed out, and then it could propagate and continue. That's the basic, simple idea. And what they showed, if you have this kind of a channel of contagion, if it is a capital channel, the complete market structure is the most stable one. And what is a complete market structure, it's this kind of structure, where everybody is connected to everybody. That's a complete network. So there's edges between all possible pairs of nodes. And in this case, if you only have the capital channel, it's the best possible thing to have. Why? The intuition is in a way simple. The intuition is this network works as an insurance system. And any shock, because it's a complete network, is kind of diffused, it's kind of diluted on the whole network. And so more people survive and the network is more stable. And this is the reason also why no one was thinking about financial networks, and everybody was happy with the financial liberalization and the increasing complexity of the networks, because the idea was, hey, this is the good thing to do. This makes everything more stable, which was completely and utterly wrong. How does it actually work? So this is, I explained up till here. This is the thing I explained. A bank dies, and then in the next stage, you could lose your capital because of the credit loss, and then you would die yourself. But then, of course, you have the contagion of the network. So then, what I explained is the first jump. Someone dies, maybe someone else dies, but then it starts propagating in all directions. And what people have done, what I have done, and most papers on contagion in the past, if they had data, what they were doing is, okay, let's randomly kill banks or groups of banks or correlated banks and see what happens with my network. And then we make some measures of that, and we say, okay, it's right, it's not right. That was the whole research. A very simple way of looking at it. So let's assume a network. You have banks A, B, C, and D. And the arrows, they show the credits. So the direction of the arrow is the direction of the credit. B has lent to A, C has lent to B, C has lent to A, and D has lent to B, right? That's my structure. It's not a complete structure, but it's also not a ring structure. It's kind of a realistic structure of banks. What happens with the capital channel is the following. A gets hit. We don't know why. So they did something stupid, they have a bad loan, or something happened, they have a tsunami, so they die. What happens then? Of course, the problem is B and C have given money to A. In the short run, they will not see it back. In the long run, there could be some legal proceedings, and they work it out, and maybe in 5 years they get it back. Like in Lehman Brothers, some judicial case took 5 years. So that means that in the short run, it's gone. So we're going to assume that's it. No more money. Now the question is, what will happen to B and C? And then you look at the fine detail of the notes. So you don't only need the contracts of these banks, you also need their capital, their liabilities, actually their whole balance, and their whole profit and loss account. Now let's assume B looks like this. So what I put there on the right-hand upper side, it's a balance of bank B. And on the left-hand side, you will see the assets. And on the right-hand side, you will see the liabilities. And the liabilities, okay, you have capital, you have other liabilities, for example, deposits, and you could have interbank borrowing. And on the asset side, you have interbank lending and other assets. And other assets could be mortgages, loans to firms, investment loans, could be CDOs, could be all kinds of stuff, securities, right? And so what is going on? What I'm basically saying is, okay, this B guy loses 100. So what will happen? Imagine this is the full 100. The problem is, this 100 exceeds the capital. In fact, there's a negative capital of this size. So this guy, B, because of the crisis, is at the same very moment insolvent. He will die too. That's it. He burns. But now, of course, if he burns, the problem is that C loses another 100. The C guy loses another 100. And actually, D loses too. And that's how the propagation works. And now the question will be, does C survive? Does D survive? If both C and D dies, you have two more and three more. And it can be a domino system, right? Where everybody starts falling. So let's look at C. Well, C is like this. So what happened with C? C already lost. So this is bank C. They have other liabilities, capital. It's better capitalized. It's a strong bank. And they have interbank lending from two guys. The first 200, they lose when A failed. That's this 200. But look, they still have some capital left. They will have to replenish, but they're still not bankrupt. Of course, if now also B fails, they lose this 100 too. And then at this moment, they're insolvent too. And then that's it. Gone bank. And then if this bank has a connection to D, in a direct or indirect way, D will start failing too, and then... Again, I explain this in detail that you really understand what's going on. But remind you, this is not what happens. It's irrelevant for the real contagion, it turned out to be afterwards. This is what most people still think, and many papers still do. They model the capital contagion, but that's not the issue. It's not what really makes banks fail at all. This is directly from the paper. I just show you how graphics have progressed. So I went to the Allen and Gale paper and got out of their paper their graphs. This is their complete network. I think mine is much more fancy, no? Look at mine. This is much better, no? So things have improved over the time. And they also have a ring network. And they call this the connected incomplete structure. But nowadays, we call it a ring network. And they say this is the most fragile one, the most vulnerable one. So that's like the benchmark case. The complete is perfect, the ring is bad, everything in between is like in between. If you believe Allen and Gale. Okay. And this is the money center structure. This is a structure that, or sometimes we call it also the mesh structure, or if it's perfect like this, it could be a star network. But we'll talk about this later. This kind of structure is what you see often in banking systems. You have core periphery structures with several layers, slooi. So you have a few core banks and a ring around it, and a ring around it, and a ring around it. And then you can start thinking about centrality. in all kinds of forms and how these things actually happen. Okay. However, in reality, what really happens is the essence is not capital, it is liquidity. And if banks actually do die in real contagions, it's usually because of funding losses. They lose money in other ways than losses through credit. How does that work? So the first step is the same. The lenders have a credit loss because of some kind of shock. At this moment, the old channel still happens, but there's a new channel. And the new channel is, okay, we also have a funding loss. Now imagine you have given me money. So you have, I'm your borrower, and you die. You could say, well, I'm sorry, your bank dies. Your bank dies and the money bank dies. And you could say, you're in trouble, not me, because I got money from you. But the point is, this money will disappear, there will be some kind of legal proceeding, and the money I got from you will go back. I will pay back, and it will be distributed among your creditors. So I have to find some new liquidity. I have to find someone else who gives me this liquidity. In normal times, this is very easy. But the problem is, if you have a contagion in a system, this exactly is the worst thing. To find new sources of liquidity. And that's how the contagion actually runs on financial networks in reality. It's through funding losses. And this was not modeled at all before the financial crisis. Nobody was thinking about it at all, in fact. So the funding loss will erode the liquidity. That's very important. And then, because of this, what you get, and that's the crucial thing that we saw in this crisis, if you have a funding loss, so I owe her 100, I give the 100 back, but I don't have the 100. Maybe I only have some securities, so I have to sell securities or some other stuff to pay back her who is in bankruptcy. But if everybody at the same time is selling stuff, prices will drop dramatically. And then you get fire sales. So the problem actually is, if you have liquidity runs, banks see that liquidity drain away, everybody starts hoarding, nobody wants to borrow to each other. So the only solution is sell securities. But if everybody is selling securities, prices fall, you have fire sale losses. And the fire sale loss, again, depletes your capital and your liquidity. So, and it's a mixed thing, it all happens together. The capital thing, the liquidity thing, and the fire sale thing all happen together. Actually, in the current crisis in 2008, what did we see? We saw how the prices for CDOs, collateralized debt obligations, went as low as 10% of the nominal value. Because everybody at the same time started selling. Think about house prices in the US. There was obviously a bubble, but because all the banks had to start selling at the same time, because they had liquidity problems and had these issues, home prices fell by 40%. So, and that, of course, then they lose massively, and that's how you get contagion too. So there's actually two reasons why you can default in this kind of complex contagion. One, you could become insolvent because the initial loss, the money you have lent to someone else, doesn't come back and it's larger than your capital, or because the fire sale loss is larger than your capital, or the sum of both. It all adds up, and that could wipe out your capital. Or you just don't find enough liquidity. I have to pay money back, I sell securities, but prices are low, and it's just not enough to have my liquidity needs covered. And so I'm illiquid, and I die too. And as the central bank pumps in money, what they did. And these are the two things that happens. And actually, if you look at, for example, the Russian 2004 crisis and the 2008 crisis in Europe, this is the main thing. Funding liquidity runs and fire sales. That's what happened, not the capital thing. And it has been very badly explained in newspapers, I think, and also in academics sometimes. Okay. So, let's have a look again to make very specific what is going on. Right? You have the same structure, but now who will die? C will die. And C is the guy who gave money to B and to A. So the point now is A and B have a liquidity problem. The money of C they'll have to give back, usually in advance, because they have these proceedings. And then they have a big hole in their balances. They have to find new liquidity. Okay. This is gone. Oh, that's bad. Let's look at B again. What is happening to B? B is the same bank as before, but I now, this used to be other assets, now it's securities. So we assume bank B looks like this. I mean, we're going to make a few different assumptions of bank B. We're going to change the balance later on to show you the different possible contagion channels, essentially. So what's going on? All right. This disappears. So this is the 100, right? So this 100 that B loses, that's all his interbank lending and liquidity. This is interbank borrowing, right? So he's losing a part of that, and part of it he can cover by interbank lending and liquid assets. So he has some liquid stuff. So what he could do, bank B, to cover this loss of 100, this loss, he could say, okay, I will stop my interbank lending. So Moni had given me money, I have to give that back, but I gave you money. So I say, give me money back so I can give her money back. But then you have a liquidity problem. And so that's how the funding losses backwards spread to the system.
But B has 150 in interbank lending assets.
Yes.
So why can't he just cover his borrowing by you know, demanding that back?
He does.
So he's okay?
Up till now, he's okay. B is not dead yet. Yeah. So this is the, exactly, that's exactly the point. So in this case, there's no further contagion. B, so I'm B, I get a hit from you, but I covered by hitting you, actually, and by some liquid assets, and I'm fine. Maybe you're not fine, but I don't care, right? That's not my problem. Yes?
Could you clarify something about the timing of this? I mean, maybe this is just a naive question, but I would think if C dies, that B might have years to pay back the money when you know as the sort of legal proceedings are going on.
Well, these things can happen very, very quick because the maturities of these things are often a day, a week. You're talking about repos, interbank lending, overnight lending. These are very short maturities. And they're massive amounts, right? So some of this, so like the bank Dexia, half of its balance sheet was interbank borrowing, actually. And a lot of it was, some of it was long term, but a lot of it was actually short term. So at the moment, another bank, Fortis, a Belgian bank, at the moment they went bankrupt, they had 54 billion interbank borrowing in the very short run. Less than a week. So it means by the end of the week you have to pay back, right? And you lose, you have to pay back. It will not be rolled over, that's the thing. So Moni is bankrupt, she's not gonna roll over. So I have to give it back, and then I have to find someone else. Because I have these long run assets, I invested in mortgages and stuff I cannot get back. And my funding is gone. I need to, usually if things are fine, I find someone else. But now I don't, and that's the issue. That's the issue. So it's a good question. The timing is essential, but the point is often these maturities of these things are really short. So, okay, so this bank B is still fine. They're alive and kicking, well, not kicking a lot, but still a bit kicking. But, of course, imagine they lose this also, right? Imagine that the interbank borrowing 100 is the full thing. It's everything. So, if this were to be the 100, I would be fine. I can cover it with liquidity. But imagine this 100 is actually the full thing. Then the problem is, the whole 100 I lose is more than my liquid assets and my lending I can get back. So now, yeah, ask.
No, you have 150. And here you have 100.
No, but I'm just assuming, look, so these are two different banks B, right? Assumption one, this is this bank B1, and this thing is 100. Then this bank B will be fine. But assume another bank B where this is 100. So because I have all the different scenarios, and I will change the assumption of the assets, right? Otherwise, I can't put it in one figure. So now we have another bank B. Maybe I should call it bank B prime or something, and bank B prime prime. I should do that, actually. It's going to clarify a lot. So this is bank B prime. And Bank B prime has a little different structure. They're more heavily on the interbank borrowing. They have less capital. So in this case, part of the 100 they can recover by liquid asset interbank lending. But some of it, like 30, is uncovered. They will have to sell securities. And the problem is, to find this amount of money, they will have to sell more securities because they will have fire sale loss if everybody is selling at the same time. Actually, the fire sale loss was as high as 90% in 2008. Massive fire sale losses. So this will happen. You have to sell this much securities to cover this liquidity. And your liquidity problem is now solved. Solved with a lot of pain. But the problem is, now you have a solvency problem. Because the fire sale loss will eat away your capital. Not completely. So this is a fire sale loss. Why? Okay, you have sold this amount to cover this amount. But in your asset side, this is gone. So this is actually exactly the devaluation of your securities, in a sense. It's your fire sale loss. And this is how illiquidity translates in insolvency. Very quickly, if you have these contagious runs. And so people say, is it liquidity, is it solvency? It's a idiotic question. Because they are, of course, they interact completely. You cannot split capital from liquidity in a contagion moment. They affect each other all the time. Okay. Now imagine bank double prime. This is bank double prime. It's just a different bank again. But there's a difference. Bank prime is well capitalized. Okay. Bank prime has a big capital. Right? But bank double prime is a bank that has been taking a lot more risk. And their capital, the capitalization I should say, is less big. Smaller capitalization. So bank double prime is this bank. So, and they have less capital and more other liabilities. For example, subordinate bonds and what have you. For this bank, all the rest is the same, right? So they have the same interbank borrowing. This they can cover with the same liquidity. This they can cover with the fire sale. But the problem now is the fire sale loss will wipe out the capital. These guys die. And they die on, you would think, oh, they die because of insolvency. But actually it's the liquidity that kills them. And the fire sale loss that makes them insolvent. So these things interact in very complex ways. Once you start simulating, it's, whoa, all things start happening at the same time. And the whole thing falls apart. Okay? So this guy is insolvent. Oh no, he dies. And then we could look to A and to D and things propagate again. However, you could also die because of illiquidity. Imagine bank prime, prime, prime. This is bank prime, prime, prime. They're illiquid. So it's the same bank. The only thing I changed, instead of other assets, securities they can sell. Now they don't have securities, they have other assets, and let's call these mortgages or firm loans. I can't sell that stuff. Not in a crisis. So you have this bank, they lose the 100, they can cover part of the 100 with their liquid assets and getting the money back from there. And then they have an additional thing, they would like to sell their assets to cover that loss, but they can't. Nobody wants their mortgages, nobody wants their firm loans, everybody instead is selling them. So immediately they're illiquid and they die because of illiquidity. If you would have no central bank intervening massively with trillions of dollars. Which happened, of course. But this kind of thing happens in a day. So your question about timing is, how is the time of these things? These things happen in a day, often in a part of a day. That's it. And usually the central bank is too late. They intervene when it all happens. It's like you have to imagine a house of cards, and you do one card, and it's, that's it, right? It's over. So the central banks usually are too late. They come in to pump it up again once it has fallen down. It's like these castles with air where the kids play? It's like, and the central bank blows it up again, but it has collapsed because of illiquidity or insolvency.
And so the story was Lehman?
The Lehman story was both, actually. Both. I mean, you mean Lehman Bank itself?
The Lehman Brothers.
Lehman Brothers themselves, they were completely illiquid, actually, yeah. Completely illiquid, yeah. Nobody wants to give him any money anymore. Yeah. Okay. Right. However, that's not the whole story. This is now a paper of your good friends, actually. have you read it? I guess you read it, of course. So I'm going to explain the paper in very, very general terms. Without any mathematics, but I will explain the intuition, what they're actually doing. And in this paper, what they actually say is, so you have this conjecture of Haldane. Haldane is of the guy of the financial stability of the UK. So the man who's supposed to guard the stability of the banks. And what he said a long time ago, actually in 2009 in his speech, he said, look, it seems that banks have a robust yet fragile property. And by that he meant banks seem to be robust, the banking system, to small shocks. But if the shock is big, all at once everything collapses. And that's what he calls the robust yet fragile property of the banking system. Of the network, actually, not of individual banks. And what they show, they make a fantastic model, and they show if the magnitude of the shock is limited, is small, then indeed a more equal distribution of interbank obligations, say the complete network, is less fragile. So basically what they do, they say if shocks are small, Allen and Gale are right. The complete network works. It is the one that absorbs most of the shocks. It's the most stable one. And the ring financial network is crap. So they kind of say, if shocks are small, Allen and Gale are completely right. Rings are bad, complete is good. And anything in between ring and complete is worse than complete. So this is like a continuum of getting more close to completeness, and that will make you more and more stable. That's their idea. And what is the idea behind it? Okay. It's the idea that Allen and Gale implicitly already had, but not really said. But now they make it very explicit. They say, look, what you essentially do is, in this whole network, imagine all of us are banks, nodes, and we have all edges with each other, and it's complete. The thing is the following. All of us individually may have some excess liquidity somewhere. The more complete the network is, the better we're going to use this excess liquidity spread everywhere to cover the losses of the system, to make the system more stable. Or to put differently, it works as a massive liquidity insurance system. Someone gets shocked, and the shock gets distributed over the whole complete network, and everywhere we will seek out the liquidity surpluses to cover the losses. And that's the intuition, why this complete network is actually the most stable network. And that's a very smart idea. So it is an absorption system, a security system. However, So this is good, this is bad, and Allen and Gale are right. However, if the shocks are big, then the opposite is true. If the shocks are really big, you can show that the complete network is actually very fragile. And the optimal network is somewhere in between the ring network and the complete network. It's somewhere in the middle. And in that way, they really talk about the crisis, right? Because we saw in the crisis, we have a very complete network, a not so big shock, and everything collapsed. And the reason was probably it's too complete. Something, a mesh network, something in between ring and complete is much better. That's what they say. So the ring is still the worst one, but now the complete network is very prone to contagion. It's pretty bad. So Allen and Gale are wrong. Finally, it's not a very good paper in the first place. And they are wrong. Yes, we are so happy. We don't need to cite these guys anymore. For all things are saying that they were wrong, finally. We can do that without any risks. So, and what is the intuition of the model? The intuition of the model is, if you have weak interconnections, what happens is the strongest banks, they will bear most of the losses, and they will protect the system against other things. So if you have weakly connected systems, here and there will be trees and branches in the system that get not touched by the contagion. Because at the top of the tree, somewhere there's a strong bank that can absorb their shock, and it stops. So imagine you have a star network, and then it branches out. So you have one in the middle, then you have all the other ones around it, and then these ones have a tree. Now, the thing is, if my guy on top survives the shock, the whole tree is protected. But imagine that this tree has connections with other trees, then it could still go this way. It could come from the backside. But if you have so weakly connected systems, you have protected branches, and the whole system is much more likely to survive. And the interesting thing is, this is exactly the structure most financial networks have. They have some kind of incomplete structure, sometimes a money center structure with a few banks in the center, sometimes a kind of peripheral core periphery structure with some degree of peripherality. So that's what we see in reality. Yeah? So basically, the same thing that makes a financial network stable in some conditions, completeness, makes it less stable in other conditions. And the condition is the severity of the shock.
Yeah. But a network that's between the ring network and a complete network is not a core periphery network?
Not necessarily, no.
Right?
No. It's just one of the possibilities, actually.
Okay.
Yeah. So a core periphery is between, it's one of the possibilities between a ring and a complete. But it's not the only one, I agree. So you have a few...
Because it's so I think they had a convex combination effectively between a complete network and a core periphery. You need to have an asymmetric structure, right?
Yes, you do.
So, in fact, we never observe the optimal networks.
Well, so what they do is they start from the ring and then they keep adding edges, and you from a ring you can keep adding edges, pass through a core periphery to finally find the complete. So in that sense, it's in between. That's the thing they do. So now this is bad. Oh, we should be careful with it. Huh? So of course, most financial networks are not complete or ring networks. That's of course blah blah blah. Most networks look like this. This is the way most networks more or less look. Huh? They call it a mesh network, and it has some core periphery structure. To some extent, there are money centers. This is a kind of money center, but then there are little cycles within the same level. So you have cycles on cycles on cycles that are connected in complex ways. That's a mesh network. And many networks look like this, and that's in a way pretty stable. But this is a very special network, the star network. Why is it so special and interesting? A star network is very stable if mama survives. If mama dies, that's it. They all die, right? So this is the kind of system that would be really safe if the central guys are safe. These we today name the systemically important banks. There's a whole wave in financial literature, the Global Financial Stability Board, and they talk about the SIFIs, the systemically important financial institutions, or the global SIFIs, and these are the ones we need to protect. Some people have joked about the current crisis, that the current crisis could be compared to syphilis, right? All the SIFIs died. But well, that's a pretty bad joke, actually. So now, the interesting thing is, regulation is moving into this way. Because financial networks, I've been talking about financial networks as if it was always notes, banks, and lendings, contracts. However, in reality, it's often financial contracts that are not loans. For example, a swap. For example, a CDS, a credit default swap. So some kind of derivative. So there's plenty of complex financial contracts between banks, between nodes, that make a network. And that was also part of the current financial crisis, actually. Yeah. It was also a big part of the Russian 98 crisis, in a way. The currency futures. Right? That collapse the whole system. So what we are doing now, we are saying that CCPs, central clearing parties, are the best thing to do. So one of the problems was, one of the problems was in the current crisis that all these complex contracts are traded over the counter. And over the counter means nobody knows. I have a contract with you or with you or with you, and we know. But nobody else knows. And it can be massive. This was half of the trades running in the trillions of dollars. So there's a massive amount of trade in very complex contracts, and nobody knows. And that was part of the Lehman Brothers story too. The problem, at the moment it failed, they had to work it out. And they're still working it out. They're still not completely finished, because nobody has any idea what the contracts actually are. So we all want money from Lehman, but we don't know, this uncoordinated attack for the money, basically. So that was a big, big mess. And the idea now is, it's driven by the G20, the Financial Stability Board, let's reform this thing. And let's ask all these banks to trade these complex things over central clearing parties. And I'll explain what it is. So, and it's LANA, right? So the idea is, if you have the CCPs, there will be less contagion and less likelihood, because everyone is dealing with mama, not dealing with each other, and mama is strong. And mama knows everything, even more importantly, of her kids. So if one of the kids behaves badly, mama knows everything, and she can deal with it. That's the thing with CCPs. Right? How does it actually work? If you step into CCP, they do what they call novation. So we still have the bilateral contracts, but we replace our bilateral contract with a contract to the CCP. So if I have a deal with my brother, no. This deal with my brother, in both ways, we say, no, we make it a deal with mama. I don't give money to my brother and my brother to me. We both give the net money to mama. That's what we do. So that's an innovation of contracts. That means that the CCP is a buyer and seller to every contract. And it's in the middle. Right. So, and it has to be a star, right? It has to be a star. What we will ask is, we will ask margins. Because we can promise each other contracts, mama can come in the middle of the contract, but then we have to promise mama we'll always do what she says. And how do you do this? We put some deposit. We call this the margin. And the margin is to cover any changes in risks. If things go wrong, they will take the margin away. So mama has your savings, and if you don't behave, they will take your savings away. So you can't go to the candy store anymore, right? Essentially, that's the margin thing. So imagine B and A again, the same B and A as before, and they have a CDS contract. So I sold the CDS B and B again, I sold CDS to A. Okay. The problem is, usually it goes like this. In the CDS market, there's many of these things. Rings, very unstable rings. I trust you. I'll do the same thing. I'm back. Okay. So the thing is, if one of these guys fails, it becomes very tricky. So say B fails. He promised a contract to A, but the contract doesn't exist anymore. B is gone. Then the problem is C and A are completely unbalanced. Right? Because now it's pretty balanced, right? They promised 90, but they have 80, so they have only a net position of 10. And here they got 90, but they promised 10. They have a net position of 10 in the different directions. So there are small net positions, but big gross positions. And the thing is, if something goes wrong, it's the gross position that dies out, and then the whole thing will fall apart. Because all at once, the only thing that will be left, probably the 90 and the 100 will actually go, because in the short run, this is just gone. And all at once, these guys have a huge net position. That could be very unstable. So what do we do instead? We do this. That's CCP. So, for example, take the position of A with all other members. A got 100 from other members and gave 80 from other members. So the net position of A with all the rest is 20. So what will happen is CCP has a novation contract of 20 with A. That's what it does to CCP. These things are happening, eh? It's not just theory. Massively, half of the contracts now or today traded on a range of CCPs, and that's new. So this is happening as we speak. And the same, okay, look at B, it's 90 and 10. You could have 1,000 members, right? So you just took all positions, you net them all out. This is still simple, but you have thousands of members, you get all the positions, all others, you net them out, and you have one link to the CCP. And that's it. So instead of a very complex, close to complete network, what we're going to create is a simple ring network, and then hope that mama is good. Yes?
May I ask a question? There can be different conditions between A and C and C and B. So if A gives the money 80 to C, maybe for 13%, and C gives money to B for example.
Wait. These are financial contracts, but there's no interest rates on them. There's a CDS or CDO is just a promise, essentially. It's a promise. You could think of it as an option or a future. It's a promise. There's no interest rates on it. It's a promise. So we exchange promises. There's no interest rates on this. I hear your question. Yeah.
Why don't they just, if A gives C, for example, 18, and C then would like to give B for example, 90, he said, no, no, I will give back 80 to the A and just give B to $10 and that's it. And he's not under risk at this point.
And you're challenging the risk strategy of my example, but it's just an example, really.
Why we need this central point if we can decide themselves for us?
Okay.
Why should we?
Okay, but this is what you say is very simple to do if you have three members. Then we could actually do it ourselves. But you have 1,000 members, it's impossible, because then you have a collective negotiation process with all 1,000 and all at the same time. Because not only me, as one of the 1,000, needs to net it out with all other 1,000, but all other 1,000 need to see the same thing. That's just impossible. So what they do is they make standard contracts. So these contracts on CCPs have to be standardized. That's the problem. So you have standard contracts in CDS. So for example, CDS actually is an insurance contract against default. So CDS is, okay, I promise you, if this guy goes default, I will pay you so much. That's it. That's CDS. And these are standard contracts on all possible quoted firms. And each of one of you could sell someone else's CDS. And so then you get basically an insurance premium. And all these CDSs are standardized. But they're also, so half of the products are non-standardized, very exotic non-standard products. And that's the problem. These cannot be traded on CCPs. And so half of the complex financial networks are still OTC, over-the-counter, complex, very obfuscated. No one has any idea what is going on. But at least half of them are now on CCPs, and that should be better. Jasna, you have a question.
Yeah, if CCP is bad, Mama, who will control Mama?
Yes, that's a good question. We come to this later. That's a very good question, indeed. So the problem then becomes, as people say, CCPs are financial market infrastructure. They become not something that they are not. They become financial market infrastructure. And what if they behave badly? What if they are crooks? What if they go bankrupt? And then now you get demands that CCPs, or in general, other financial market infrastructures, should have access to the central bank liquidity window, because they should have a lender of last resort, because if they die, who will solve it? So things are turned on their head again. So this discussion is raging, actually. That's a very good question. So what will happen now? Imagine things go wrong with the CCP. B fails, 10 is gone. So at least now the thing is not as bad as it used to be, right? So you still have 10 and 20. And so mommy has to deal with it now. So for A and B, A and C, initially nothing changes. One of these, one of your kiddies fails, mom has to deal with it. How could you deal with it? You could rebalance. You could say, okay, do you want to take on the extra 10? So the first thing mama will do, oh, my kiddie B dies, she had to give 10 to me, and you ask to kiddie C, do you want to give the 10? So you ask C to write another CDS at some price to cover it up. And we'll talk about how you cover the losses. So if you have many members, it's easy, because you see all the information, to find people who want to cover the holes and rebalance the whole system. So that's because all the information is central, it's easy to do. So you could rebalance it in a very simple way. Go from, you have this light? I probably do. So you go from 10 to 20. Voilà. Exactly. I couldn't have said it better. Now, things could get worse if B is actually very big, because it's a subsidiary of a SIFI. So a SIFI is a systemically important financial institution. It's a huge shop, Deutsche Bank, Goldman Sachs. And they have this huge position on the CCP, a true B. So maybe this thing is too big to take over. And no one else, so there's a huge chunk of B, no one wants to take it over. It's impossible to rebalance. Then the problem is going to be, will the CCP go bankrupt, right? And then you have a whole set of rules how to deal with it, how to make mommy safe. So how could you do that? The first thing you could do is, okay, all of us have margins. So remember, you have to deposit money with mommy just in case things go wrong. And mommy will take it away if you're bad. So the first thing, of course, they will do, they will use the margin. So if this guy goes bankrupt, B, We will take their margin in their account and use it to convince other people to take up the loss. So we go to the initial margin, and you have a default guarantee fund. So that's interesting, actually. All the CCP members, they pay up money in a fund. And the fund is just hanging around, and it's there for if things go wrong. That's mama's little insurance pot, right? If things go wrong, we all pay up, and then we can use the money. The first thing they will do is just take the margin and the default money of the guy that is failing and use it to cover the losses. But if it's big, it's not going to help. And then this is a first tranche of CCP capital. So the CCP, mommy has her own money. And she will have to put in some of her own money. And this is just to make incentives work. If mommy is always going to be saved by someone else, mommy won't care and she will do whatever. And then they have no skin in the game. So they make sure mommy has skin in the game and that is some capital paid up. And then we're going to look at all the other kids of mama, all the other survivors, and their default fund contributions we will take to cover the loss of this one member. That's the idea. So it's really an insurance fund. And then, in the end, it could go as, and then, so this is always the same, up till 3. From 4 on, and I will go further later on, I will explain 4 more and more in detail, things become very exotic, and every CCP have their own rules. It can become very different. So these three first things are clear, and then one thing that often happens now is you ask new contributions. So you go to all the other kids, say, oh, okay, Sasha was bad, please give me some money. You all have a collective fund for Sasha, to cover his losses, or her losses. That's one of the things that typically happens. And that's kind of tricky, because actually, if you think of it, it works like this with banks. For example, in the Netherlands, the deposit insurance works like this. There's no fund. But if a bank would fail, the government would pay, and then all the banks have to pay that back. It's exactly the same logic. So that means that banks have also incentives to watch each other, right? If someone is really doing crazy things, you go tell mama, mama, look at him, what is it? Because if it goes wrong, you have to pay, right? You have to pay. So it's also about incentives. If everybody knows this beforehand, you all have incentives to watch the others to some extent. That she or he doesn't do too crazy things. Usually he, actually, if it's crazy, because then you'll have to pay yourself.
Just want to ask a small question, maybe I misunderstood something, but why mommy is so moral? I mean, why is she so good? Who controls her? I mean, if mama has money, she can create lots of banks and just got lots of money on her own and just don't care about her children. I mean, these banks could just, I don't know, they can just fail all, but still her banks, she can just start cheating because she's the only one who has the money. So who controls the mama?
Good, a very good, a very Russian question. it's very good to be paranoid about mama. So usually mama is, for example, a few in Belgium, they are huge clearing houses, very old, reputed clearing houses. But you're actually right. How do you know mama is not going to be bad? The answer is supervision. So the financial supervision authorities in every country also have the authority and obligation actually to supervise the CCPs. So they have to comply to all kinds of regulations and write reports and they get visits on site and all that.
But these CCPs are country specific, they're not global? A bit of an issue?
They are located in a country. For example, Clearstream is in Belgium. It's huge. And it's settlement in the whole world. There's another one.
Do different CCPs need to coordinate between themselves?
Yes.
Okay.
That's a big issue.
Do they?
No, that's a big issue. That's a big issue. I'll come to this. That's a very good question. Yes. Sergei?
Talking about incentives. If all players in the market had to pay for failures of others, then they would, logically, they would prevent other players to come into the market, as well as they can use these complaints in order to compete unfairly. Is it true?
They use the complaints to compete unfairly?
Yeah, so if they just call mom and say, oh, this guy is doing something wrong, just because they don't like him.
Yeah. But of course, you have to realize mama always knows more than anyone else, right? So this is the, if this is cheap talk, Mama's going to know because she sees all the contracts. So maybe she wasn't watching very well, but if you come tell, she can check everything. So telling someone with cheap talk is impossible in principle.
But what if today the players will organize a sort of DDoS attack, just spamming Mama with failure?
Again, a very Russian question. What if everybody was bad and colluding to kill someone? I'm going to assume this actually doesn't happen in the real world if in very big CCPs. What you describe could happen in very small groups, because what you say, you require collusion between a large enough set of members to attack someone, right? And I'm kind of going to assume if the group is big, this is prohibitively expensive. The coordination effort for this collusion, it's not going to happen. But in small groups, it's precisely going to happen, right? It happens all the time.
Can't these, you know, subsidiaries of SIFI create sort of moral hazard for Mama? Because, you know, Mama bails out everyone. So they just, you know, turn to more risky strategy.
That's a very good question. And I would say yes, that's a problem. And it's actually increasingly a problem because now Mama, CCPs also have access to, in many cases, to the central bank. They're talking about it. And it seems like if they're going to do it. So in that case, it gets even worse. So you need this liquidity support maybe in crisis times. But if you know it up front, then Mama would say, let this big son of huge grandmother, my niece, right, Goldman Sachs, let her and him do all the kind of crazy stuff. Let them go crazy. Because if it goes wrong, I can go to the ECB. So that would make things very bad. So there's a risk of that. Of course, the more players you have, the smaller the risk. If you have all the big banks also, it's not going to happen. So this is basically, they call it the waterfall. The CCP default management waterfall. The economics have all kinds of waterfalls, right? You have vadapats everywhere. But this is one, the CCP default vadapat. Okay. Now, this is what I said. It can become much more complicated, right? So this is something I got from an actual existing CCP describing what they do. So if things go wrong, they first use the default as resource, as I said, the initial margin, his or her default fund contribution. Then you're going to do the capital, skin in the game. Here it is, skin in the game. And then we're going to actually go to the members. So you start with individual resources, then the Mama's resources, and then you start to mutualize. You start to spread it on the system, right? And then things become very interesting. So one of the things they actually do is this VMGH. It's the variation margin haircut. And this is variation margin haircut. Okay, how to explain this? In the CCP, there are all kind of trades going on. If someone fails, in the meanwhile, trades go on and on and on and on. And at every point in time, at the end of every day, all positions are expressed in market value. They mark to market. And if you have unrealized gains, what you basically have is your margin account improves. So you have some unrealized money on your margin account that you get. And if your mark-to-market goes bad, so you did bad gambles or bad trades, and actually you start losing, but it's not realized, it's virtual losses, you start to lose on your margin account. But these are gains and losses after the default, but before the workout of the default. So what they do is they shave off all these losses, these virtual losses. Because they basically say, look, this is like, what is the alternative? The alternative is bankruptcy. If there's bankruptcy, none of the gains and losses made after bankruptcy will be a deal of the working out of the bankruptcy. We stop at the moment of bankruptcy. So if one of these guys failed and it's really big and we need to go to bankruptcy, the only last resort option is let's go to these margin accounts. And if you are happy to gain after default, we'll take all the gains. That's it. And we use this also to solve the problem. But this is already very, let's not go into these technical details, that's very technical. So the question starts to arise, and this is a discussion today, That's your question and your question. Huh? So we have the central clearing house here, the CCP. That's my CCP, actually. So you have all the banks. The central bank is the ECB, or the Centrale Banque RSSIA, if you want. And this is the financial market infrastructure. That could be a CCP. Is a CCP an FMI? And if it is, tendencies are that they will have access to the central bank. But then if you do that, the CCP will, money will be very safe, but also have very bad incentives. And then you get this game, will there be extra more hazard? And actually, do we improve? Or would we end up with something worse than we started with? That's going to be a very big discussion, and it rages in academics at the moment. Forget about this. That's too technical. I just said it in words. And by the way, I insist, since John is not here, I insist by the end of my second talk to have violated all of his rules structurally, one by one, but only in one slide. I give one violation, one slide. That's it. What you could also do as a last resort is the following. So, so imagine this guy fails, and it's a short swap. And the counterpart is a long swap, say, and the opposite position. What you could do is you could say, okay, this guy is gone. Remember what we did in the very beginning, right? In the very beginning, this, what is the point? This guy dies, then, and I find someone else to cover it up. And this is this guy, C. But now, it's impossible, we have done all the things, we can't find no one else. What you could say is, okay, we have all the others, like C, that have this position, not this position, instead of short. Let's have all the people with the C, and let's distribute the loss, this 10. Let's distribute over all the Cs. Everybody's just going to pay a share. That's it. The alternative is bankruptcy. So fuck up, shut up, this is it. Everybody will pay part of it. And this is what they call partial tear-up. So basically, some big guy dies on CCP, and all of us, all the rest who have jobs in position, will lose part of the contract, just our share in the contract. And it's a way efficient. And while it's efficient, it's also mimicking what would happen if it really is a bankruptcy. If it really is a bankruptcy, they're going to distribute all the remaining assets over all the members. So why not just distribute all the losses and survive in the same way? That's the idea. Huh? All right. So, of course, things could go very wrong still, and you could end up here. And then that's going to be very, very messy, but still better than the 2008 crash. So imagine all of the things I explained, this whole cascade, the partial tear-up, none of it is enough. And still, the CCP falls apart. Or maybe, because of your crash cascade, there's a bad mama. Mama runs to the Bahamas, and that's it. She takes all the money, all the margins, all the haircuts. In some countries, I could imagine it happening, actually. So say you have an MMM, Peter Mavroidi kind of CCP kind of thing, and all the money is gone. That's it. Oh, it's gone. So what would happen? Okay, you have to resolve the CCP. You could stop all the contracts. That's going to be very messy. Or you could recapitalize the CCP. And then you have the whole discussion again. Thank you. You have the whole discussion again. Okay, if you're going to have to recapitalize CCP, won't we have more hazards? So what should we do if things go wrong? Bail it out? Or let it go bankrupt? But if it goes bankrupt, then remember what I said in the very beginning. A star network is very safe if mama is safe. If mama isn't safe, if there is a resolution process for mama and we just let it fail, everybody will have a massive shock. And then probably it could infect the whole system. And you have contagion to all the CCPs and things keep falling apart, right? So that's not all too clear how this would run out. Now, Sasha asked, what about coordination between CCPs? Precisely. Because things are pretty clear if there's one CCP. In the case of one CCP, A, B, C, it's clearly an improvement. Things get simpler, mama has all the information. If things go wrong, you're better able to manage it. And you can manage it with less collateral, right? But you could have this. And this is the reality. There are many CCPs for the same kind of contracts, and they compete. And in reality, it could look like this, right? And then if CCPs don't coordinate, things could become very, very bad too. Yeah.
But why can't you apply the, because they all have you know, some position these CCPs. Why can't you apply the same logic as you applied to banks from the Ajumola Osla Talba Salehi paper to CCPs and make sure that their structure between them is one that is like banks? Or is that not feasible? Because they can, in principle, lend to one another, right? So if something goes wrong with me, I can go to you. So in principle, we could all have net positions.
Yes.
And you could create incentives to make sure that the network between the CCPs is an optimal one.
Yes. I'll have to deal with something right now. Okay, good question. Now, first of all, CCPs are not so many. There are maybe 15 big ones in the world. So it's very hard to make a corporate free structure of CCPs. However, also reminds, you could say they could always work it out, but they compete, right? If another fails, they don't have really good incentives to help out the other. Actually, they could rather say, let's kill the other. So the solution, or take it over or something, right? So the solution seems to be the following. So if you have this kind of a situation, so imagine B is a member of CCP2 and A is a member of CCP1. If this is the situation, what will happen is, in fact, A and B can have no trade, which is quoted on a CCP or account on a CCP, and they will resort to OTCs, to over-the-counter trading. And of course, since banks are free to choose any CCP they want, and many small banks do not have the resource to be in many CCPs, you still have this problem that you create a lot of over-the-counter trades because two parties are not on the same CCP. How could you solve it? You could ask CCPs to have accounts with each other. That's what we call interoperability. And CCPs have a system of margins with each other. And they do the underlying accounting, and that's how you solve it. But this is very new. There's one paper of Duffy on this, and we're still establishing it. So at the moment, most CCPs have no interoperability margin. So, and this whole, the question you ask is exactly the question today in research. How will we deal with the structure between CCPs? What is the efficient way to deal with it if things go wrong? So we are just thinking about it. It would be a good thing for you to do that, actually. Yeah. It's exactly the kind of network stuff you do, I think. And that's it. Are there any questions? I think I have like 5 minutes or so left, or 10 maybe. Yes, in the meanwhile, I'll get fixed. Well, my mic got fixed. Thank you, Paulina.
So please, questions.
And in your story, is bailout a good thing or a bad thing?
Bailout of a CCP or bailout of a member of a CCP? And by the CCP or by the government?
By government.
Okay. I would say by the government, I think of it as a bad idea. Okay, but that's a very good question. Let me say you something completely different. As an answer. In the current the previous crisis, 2008, 2009, 2010, what you've done around the world is massive bailouts. We just solved the problem by a lot of capital and liquidity. Just inundate everyone, right? Everyone is to his knees into the liquidity, and okay, it will be fine. The problem has been massive moral hazards and lack of restructuring, actually, especially in Europe, because there was so much money, nobody bothered to restructure a lot, and that we've seen because the crisis reappeared and reappeared and reappeared. But by now, there's a new European directive. It was voted, I think, in May 2014. It's called the Bail-in Directive. What does it mean? The new rules in Europe are, if a bank fails, one, the shareholders will be expropriated. They lose everything. Two, the creditors, especially the subordinate creditors, they take a hit. Usually they take a hit in the form of debt equity swaps. They become the new shareholders. Three, there is a bank resolution fund. So since last year, all the nations have to set up a bank resolution funds. The banks pay contributions, and within 7 years or so, I think 2020, they will join all these bank resolution funds in the European Bank Resolution Fund. And so the third one paying is the bank resolution fund. And then only in fourth instance, it would be the taxpayer, the bailout. So that moves the game we are playing from a bailout game to a bail-in game. this, I think, is very good news. I've been pushing for this very hard. I'm very happy it happened because it changed incentives completely. The real question is going to be, if one of the big mamas fails, will they have the guts to actually do it? But interestingly enough, a few small mamas failed. There was one case in Portugal last year, Banco Espírito Santo. It was the first case under this new rule, and it happened. The shareholders were wiped out. The creditors became the shareholders. There was a restitution fund that paid up. They had no money yet because it was just funded. So they borrowed money, but the banks will have to pay the loan back. So they make the banks pay, and the taxpayer actually paid almost nothing. So that was the first case. The second case is in Austria now, Hitta Bank. And Hitta Bank, which is actually a public bank of the province of Carinthia, failed. And exactly the same thing is happening. So the shareholders lose, the Bank of Carinthia, the province of Carinthia, but then other banks who borrowed money to Carinthia, they take a severe haircut. One of these banks, of course, is Dacia. They're in every bad credit you could imagine on the world. So these things have changed massively. So in that sense, I think, at least in Europe, your question should not be relevant anymore, because bailouts are actually ruled out. However, I think the real testing case for this new rule is going to be a big bank failing, because the two cases we had were small gain, right? You see that if the countries are small, think of Cyprus. When in Cyprus the banks failed, the same thing happened. The shareholders lost a lot. The big creditors, even the big depositors, actually the big Russian depositors, were kind of haircuts. They got some shares of the banks and they lost quite a lot of money. So this was already in the spirit of the new Bail-in Directive, which was then being negotiated. It was not even in place yet. So you see, things have changed the last 3 years in an interesting way. But we have to see what happens if Deutsche Bank fails for something or RBS. Then it's going to be an interesting discussion. I hope if it happens, then we still stick to it. And then really the game has changed. But interesting times. There's another question? Ah, sorry.
Just wondering about these CCPs. Who drove the idea of them being this sort of clearinghouse? Is it the banking world that said we need these CCPs, or is it a legislative sort of drive that's made them become these kind of clearing positions?
Yes, many of the CCPs are actually collectively owned by banks. Most of them, actually. Some of them have some participation of central banks or government institutions, but most of the banks are majorly owned by banks. So Clearstream is one of these examples. It's the biggest clearinghouse in Europe. It's in Brussels, and it's owned by banks. You have another one, what's the name again? The system for interbank payments, it's also in Brussels. Swiss, BIS, whatever, I forgot. Actually, the Russians use it a lot. It's a system for interbank payments around the world, whatever. And also owned by banks. So most of these infrastructure are owned by banks themselves, which is actually good for incentives, I would say.
The regulations and so forth, are these sort of built in tandem from legislation from outside, or is it the banking world that kind of generated these structures?
No. These structures, so there was hardly any regulation in the past, and these structures had been founded by banks because it was beneficial to cooperate. It was one of the rare collective endeavors of banks. But now it's getting in the field of regulation, and so these CCPs that exist get now really structured, they get supervision, they get a whole set of rules they have to comply to. And now, of course, you get different incentives. Because most of the trades have to happen on CCPs, incentives change, and you will see new CCPs pop up. We see some mergers, so this whole thing is moving right now. Yeah. You're welcome. Any other questions? Moni?
I would like to ask who supervises the CCPs?
Okay. At this moment, it's still the national supervisors. It's an interesting question because it's not too clear, actually, in some cases. So, as you know, since November last year, the 128 biggest banks in Europe are now supervised by the ECB. You have the European Banking Authority at the ECB, and supervision has from national level shifted to the supranational level. But CCPs, it's a bit unclear. So it seems to be still the national supervisors, and ECB has some role in it also. So it's a bit unclear who's actually having the final responsibility. So it's a good question, but I don't have a good answer. So let me rephrase the answer. It is at the moment the national supervisors, but I think that's a bad idea. I think it should be European, and I hope we go that way.
If that was banks' ideas to make CCPs for themselves, if I got it right, something like good guys tries to make them working better. I mean, yeah. This is easier to understand who's good and who's bad. So here was also the idea, I suppose, to be more far from government, I mean, from politicians and all that stuff. And now you say that controls partially can go to the CB or the government or someone else. So this is a bad thing that could happen. And the CCPs, the idea of the CCPs, could simply just disappear. So this could be just a problem. So there, however, their coordination, as you've already said, I mean, maybe between countries even, so in the countries that are in union, could help them. But not something that could be connected to something political in a country, to governments, parliament, or something like this.
Yeah.
So I just wondered.
It's a very, very good question. Very good question. So also again a very Russian question. your argument basically is okay. A CCP is a kind of almost social capital, voluntary coordination instrument. Banks did it because it's good for them, and that's why it works. But now you put on top governments. Supervision, government controls, government intervention, and so it will get mingled with politics and bad things will happen. And so basically you're asking actually the broader question about the connections between politics and banking. And is politics and supervision always good, or maybe sometimes makes things worse? Now, interestingly enough, this is the topic of my speech after the coffee break. So I will talk about it at length then. About politics and banking. Any other questions? Then
Thank
we go
you.
For coffee.
Yeah.
You're welcome.